Ladies and gentlemen, on behalf of Forum of Young Diplomats, I'm really honored to present you our distinguished guests of tonight's conversation, Mr. Adam Reichardt, editor-in-chief of bimonthly magazine New Eastern Europe, co-host of the Talk Eastern Europe podcast, also a mentor at the Development and Innovation Office in the College of Europe in Natolin. Adam graduated from public administration and public and nonprofit management from the George Mason University, and in political science and international relations from the University of Wisconsin. I looked for your professional career development. I found numerous articles of yours in such magazines and journals like Politico, The Atlantic Council, Index on Censorship, Dziennik Gazeta Prawna in case of Poland, and also Visegrad Insight. You work also as a member of the editorial board of the Central European Journal of International and Strategic Studies. In terms of College of Europe of Natolin, you do not only run workshops dedicated to journalists and media, but also took a part in the as the a member of the executive team of the Free Ukrainian Revolutions project that was run by the College of Europe 2 years ago. So this is what I found about you. I'm very happy to host you today in our virtual room. As I mentioned from your short professional biography, we can see that you are really into media, that this is the field of your expertise, also the international relations that are the most important for us, and that you deal with Central and Eastern European issues in general. But this is what we found, what we can find on the internet, and I believe also in your biography. But I must ask you this very important question, at least from my point of view as Paul. How did it happen that as American, you got so interested in Eastern European affairs as ended up as the editor-in-chief of the one of the most prestigious magazines in this part of Europe?
Well, Grzegorz, let me start by just thanking you and the forum for the invitation to be here. It's really an honor for me as well. And, you know, I really respect the work of the forum and what it does in terms of bringing together young people who are interested in international relations. And they have been very active. And it's really great to be a part of that. I will try to be brief because this can be a long story. I'll try to keep the short version of it. And I have, and if you need to cut me off at any point, please just feel free to. And thank you also for the introduction, the bio. So I can start maybe with your question, which is how did I get interested in international relations, especially Central and Eastern Europe? It was a little bit. No, I guess I wouldn't say it was entirely by accident. How I got to Poland was a little bit by accident, I can say. It was during my undergrad studies in Wisconsin, where I grew up. I had declared my major as political science and international relations. I was getting interested in the situation in the world, what was happening, and this was at the end of the 1990s. So it was a really interesting time. You know, I remember as a child watching the Berlin Wall fall down, and you know, following closely how the transformation began in the region of Central and Eastern Europe. And the fall of the Soviet Union. And I had really gotten interested at that point in basically trying to understand how this region is going to change because of this. And, you know, I remember as a younger child, quite young, but, you know, still during the Cold War period, before the fall, how attitudes were growing up in the United States related to the Cold War. And then we watched it end, like, on the news, basically. And this had really gotten me interested. So I think that's probably kind of the my first seeds of interest in the region. So when I was in my undergrad studies, I had met with my advisor, and I asked him if it would be possible to study in Russia, because I was interested to go to Russia and see it with my own eyes. And he suggested at that time, I think this was 1998, he suggested that I first go to Poland, because there was an exchange program with the Jagiellonian University in Kraków. Go for one semester, and if I like it, then we can go to Russia. But it was kind of like, well, let's ease you into the region, take it easy, step by step. So I signed up for the program, and it was really a great program, actually. We started with a study trip. We started in Berlin, went to Prague, Bratislava, Budapest, Vienna, and then came to Kraków, where I studied for one semester. And I really felt comfortable here, and I really felt interested in what was happening. It was really like at a seminal moment, because it was right before Poland joined NATO, and just a few years before Poland was joining the European Union. So I decided to actually, I was here for that first semester. I decided to come back the year after, 1999, 2000, to study for a full academic year in Poland, and also learn Polish language, which I'm still learning till today. But it was a great program of Polish language, culture, politics. And that was really basically what hooked me in into the region. So that was where it started. And I did one of my first research papers, actually, was on the situation in Slovakia, because it was the moment when there was some backsliding in the mid-1990s at that point. And I had already gotten interested in this process of transformation. Slovakia, I did some research on that. And then I later did some research on Polish agriculture reform ahead of EU membership. So I got myself very involved in the region.
Just a small footnote. Of course, I know your proficiency in Polish, because I had an opportunity to listen to you attending the one of the panels. But I decided to ask for the English conversation due to the fact that the New Eastern Europe is published in English. So I found it most natural to speak of it in English, as perhaps the best stories can be told about this magazine in English specifically. But one small question concerning your previous your answer. You mentioned that you watched, that you you observed the fall of the Soviet Union, of the end of the Cold War. Did you, from your American perspective, believe, or maybe you thought that it could be true, that actually the end of the Cold War really could lead to the so-called end of the history?
Yeah, maybe I was too young to think so deep about it at that time. But I have to say, it was really an optimistic time. I mean, I remember, just maybe also, you know, Americans can be pretty American-centric in their thinking. And when this, you know, when the Cold War was ending, there was a lot of discussion on how, you know, the West won, right? But I think, yes, there was, you know, the whole period of the 1990s, in my opinion, and this goes for being in the US, but also for being in Europe in general, was a period of optimism about the future. And it was really a great time, because, you know, and I was traveling the world then. I was traveling around Europe, getting to meet people. And it was a great experience, just how you instantly connect with people. And everybody was really excited about what's going to happen, what's coming next. And unfortunately, I feel like we have lost this. Yeah, we're much more pessimistic about the future and what a future might bring, and you know, the pandemic of course doesn't help about that. But I remember, you know, crossing borders still, you know, even crossing the border between Poland and Slovakia, or Poland and Germany and Italy, or Germany and France, and when that changed, it was a huge difference, and it was really nice to experience. Hopefully we remembered enough that we don't ever go back to those times.
You spoke of quite an optimism concerning your interest in the future, at that time, the future development of the Central and Eastern Europe in the late 1990s. And here is the moment to switch to the New Eastern Europe magazine itself. Actually, I went back to 2011 when it was established, and I was actually looking for some sort of context, why it was developed, the project, under which circumstances. Of course, I hope you will tell us today, but just to give you the broader picture of what we experienced at that time in terms of Central and Eastern Europe. First of all, in 2 years, earlier, in 2009, the Eastern Partnership was launched by the European Union. In 2010, another program, Partnership for Modernization with Russia, was launched as well. In 2011, Poland, from the Polish perspective, many things happen in regard to Eastern issues, affairs, studies. First of all, we have the center of the Polish-Russian Dialogue and Understanding establishment. We have Solidarity Fund that re-emerged after a short break, which exists till now, and it serves the purpose of the Eastern Partnership funding and resources. And last but not least, we have New Eastern Europe, bi-monthly magazine, being issued for the first time. It seems like you really fit the agenda at that time, because quite many quite optimistic and promising initiatives were undertaken, not to mention the last really serious treaty between Poland and Russia on small border traffic, also in 2011. So I would like you to ask about this, if the context is really mattered at that time, and what was the initial idea, and what did you try to achieve from the very beginning?
Well, you hit the nail on the head when it comes to the context. You're absolutely right that it was directly related to the launch of Eastern Partnership, particularly that because of at that time, the Minister of Foreign Affairs in Poland was Radosław Sikorski, who led it with Carl Bildt from Sweden, if you recall. So there was a lot of energy for these types of projects, a lot of resources, and I'll come back to that in a moment. But I think first I need to, of course, give credit where credit is due. And there is a Polish edition which was launched in 2008, Nowa Europa Wschodnia. Maybe you've seen it, and it is published by the Jan Nowak-Jeziorański College of Eastern Europe, which is a Wrocław-based organization. And this was, I mean, they set the precedent for the publication. And in the beginning, it was meant to be, and I have some examples that I'm going to show. In the beginning, it was meant to actually, this is actually the very first, we call it issue zero of New Eastern Europe. This is an English translation of the kind of compilation of articles that appeared in Nowa Europa Wschodnia for its first 2.5 years of existence. And that was meant to be a one-time compilation. Maybe they would do it again. And that's how I got involved, because I, through a friend of mine, was introduced to colleagues who are working on the Polish project and who works at Kolegium Europejskiej. But the interest in doing such a publication was so high. So the initial funding came to launch New Eastern Europe at the beginning of 2011 from primarily, actually, the initiative came from the mayor of Gdańsk at that time, Paweł Adamowicz, who wanted to do something big. wanted to support some initiative that would also help promote this idea that Poland has completed its transformation. This was the thinking at that time. And now it's time to promote and help the neighbors in the East with their transformation, with some of the lessons that were learned. So Paweł Adamowicz had established the European Solidarity Center in Gdańsk together with other institutions. And one of the main projects they decided to connect to that was New Eastern Europe. So they approached us and said, we want to do to this project. You have a Polish edition, which is financed by Wrocław. We'll finance the English edition. And we said, okay, sounds really nice. But we needed still enough more funding than just what they were able to offer. And we were in touch with the Polish MFA, who said, great idea. Because as you mentioned, this is where it comes in. The context was, you know, Eastern Partnership is so important. Polish presidency I think was in 2011 as well. I think Poland had the presidency of the European Council. And so Eastern Partnership Summit even was in Warsaw that year. I think it was 2011, I'm pretty sure. And so there was all this, everything was coming together at the right moment. So we launched with funding from Gdańsk and from the Polish MFA, we launched New Eastern Europe. The first issue came out in October. Here's the first issue, as you found online, October 2011. And the initial idea was to just translate articles from the Polish edition into English. So that's why you see the first editor-in-chief of New Eastern Europe is the same editor-in-chief at that time of Nowa Europa Wschodnia. It quickly came out that the audience of New Eastern Europe and the audience of Polish Nowa Europa Wschodnia are completely different, have a completely different understanding of the context of the situation in Eastern Europe, have a completely different understanding of the meaning of Eastern Europe. So we the publishers and the funders made the decision that it would be best to actually split the two journals. So this is one of the challenges that we've faced since the beginning, is that from that moment on, from issue two or issue three, New Eastern Europe was not a translation of the Polish version. So we have a completely different editorial team. We have a completely different style, approach, mission, and most importantly, geographical coverage. We also cover Central European issues. We cover Baltic states. We cover Balkans. Much more broader, because we really want to have this kind of broad discussion about the transformation, about the region, whereas the Polish Nowa Europa Wschodnia was much more about focusing on strictly Eastern Europe, particularly Belarus, Ukraine, Moldova, and Caucasus, and Central Asia as well. But we also cover Central Asia. So that's the story of the beginning of New Eastern Europe. And yes, the Eastern Partnership was really important at that time, as well as I mentioned this understanding that Poland and that the transformation, knowledge of transformation, and kind of promoting Poland as this like success story of the transformation was also, I think, embedded in the ideas behind New Eastern Europe. So, you know, originally, it kind of altered, or, you know, we evolved through time. But we really wanted to also show that New Eastern Europe is a publication which showcases Polish expertise on the region, something that is lacking in Western Europe and in the West in general. So we also, of course, you know, we seek out the best experts in Poland on Eastern Europe and also put their voices on our pages. I think it's very important to show that. And that was also part of the original idea.
Okay, so you speak of the roots of New Eastern Europe, and if you were to compare the magazine in 2011 and in 2021, which major differences in the approach, the narrative, you would point? Could you elaborate a bit about this?
Well, we do have to understand that the situation generally in the region was completely different at that time. So much has changed throughout that period, throughout those 10 years. I think our original mission remains the same, which is to really give a voice of the region in the debates on global issues. And this, I mean, this is, we've only strengthened that throughout the last 10 years. But what has definitely changed is in terms of our approach, you know, we were following very closely the situation in Ukraine in 2013, 2014 with the Euromaidan and Revolution of Dignity, and really became like, tried to not just explain what's happening, but like to be a channel. I mean, there were plenty of, you know, there were plenty of sources on what's happening there, but not just to cover what's the headline stories, but to become like more about a discussion place and a place where there are debates about what's happening in the region, and to show and influence. I think what, yeah, this is probably what's most important. We really started to want to influence thinking about the region and policy, if possible, about the region. So we really started aiming towards particular Brussels, London, Washington, kind of the most important capitals about the region, to influence and inform and enhance the understanding by providing these voices from the region. So that, I think is probably the most important element of the publication throughout the last 10 years. I think we've also taken and become more, and I don't know if this is a good thing or not, because I'm always pushing to keep a balance. But in the beginning, I think we were more journalistic in style. We had a lot more writers and kind of reports or stories, like journalistic style stories, where now I think you will find a lot more experts and analysts who are on the pages. So I still push for this kind of journalism side, that we have a balance, that there are still kind of lighter reads in the issue. But it was much easier, I have to admit, it was much easier back in 2011, I'm sorry, to do the magazine, because there were less controversial issues, maybe. You know, things were still, you know, these things were still looking up a little bit. Of course, I think Timoshenko was put in prison by Yanukovych at that time. But it was before, you know, when we're thinking about before the Maidan, you know, we were still hoping that there was opportunity to engage with Russia, to find, you know, to make progress in the region, even in Belarus or in, you know, particularly in Ukraine. And the other countries, Moldova was seen as really like a leading country. The Eastern Partnership was still considered, and I still consider it, but back then was definitely considered this channel where we will, you know, lead to EU membership of the six countries of the Eastern Partnership. And we are here now 10 years later, no, probably not much closer. I mean, maybe for a few countries, but not much closer to EU membership for them as we were back 10 years ago. So I'm not sure if I fully answered the question, but I guess it just gives you a little more insight into the evolution of the magazine. I also should point out that, and maybe not many people remember this, but when we started, we were a quarterly journal. We were publishing only 4 issues a year, and it became too difficult to be a quarterly publication because of what was happening in Ukraine in 2014. So we made a decision to switch to bi-monthly publication, and it was actually, we had no additional funding for it. So we had to sacrifice, you know, more resources of our own in order to change. But I think it was the right thing to do. We also, you may also notice that in the beginning we had like covers of text. So the first issues were just pure text on it, on the covers. And we decided also, I think it was in 2014, that we have to be more attractive. If we want people to pick up the magazine and read it, and we are distributed around the world, we have, you know, you can find us in train stations and airports all over Europe and all over the world, but we have to be competitive. And here we are at a small NGO based in Poland with a shoestring budget, you know, 3 full-time editors, How do we compete with Foreign Affairs, which has a circulation of 120,000 copies? How do we circulate with The Economist, which is, you know, a household brand? So we decided we have to try to have to get creative as well in our approach. I think this is something we also evolved during the last 10 years. And our great friend and artist and illustrator, Andrzej Zaremba, who is based here in Kraków, he's been drawing for us, I think, since the beginning, since issue 2, probably. We decided with him that we are going to move to covers with images on the cover. And the first image was was in 2014. And we had, you know, he drew Putin. I have this painting actually framed in the office as well. So that was another important change in terms of the magazine.
Yeah, I must admit that your covers really attract the attention. There is something cartoonish about them,
yes.
But at the same time, they cover really serious topics, and the colors are really the colors are strict. They are very strong, and you can clearly they can really attract your attention for the reader, and they always really match the main topic of the issue. And this is
Andrzej is really, what's really great about Andrzej, our illustrator, is that number one, he knows, he's very interested in the issues himself. He is finishing a PhD in history of Eastern Europe, and he's really into military history. So that's why anytime you see a tank, he loves drawing tanks, or Russian, you know, Russian military equipment, post-Soviet kind of style. But he really feels the region. He knows it very well. And he adds subtle, little subtle messages or little symbols in his drawings. And if you really, you know, if you look at them and study them a little bit more, you see they're actually quite complex. You know, it's not just a drawing. And he never does it on the computer. These are not graphics on the computer. These are actually drawings that he draws by hand. And so in this way, we are trying to also kind of bridge this Anglo-Saxon style of publications where you have like the New Yorker, for example, or older versions of The Economist, for example, where you have actually a graphic artist drawing the covers. And he's been really good. And there's only, I mean, I don't want to go into too many stories, but, you know, we've had times where once or twice, where actually a publisher said no to the cover, and we had to quickly scramble and redraw it. And it wasn't for political reasons. It was more about certain moods at the time, trying not to be as provocative maybe as
sensitivity.
Others. Yeah, exactly, to be a little more sensitive. But Anja usually has a free hand, and I don't think there was ever a time where I hated his cover. Maybe once or twice he might come with something and we're like, this is not what we're looking for, try again. And then he redraws it, and then we're like, perfect, you got it. It's really great. And this, I love about New Eastern Europe, like there's so many different sides to it, because we have this very, very deep expert side where we're looking at really hard issues like, you know, security situation, political situation in the region. And then we have this really creative side where we are, you know, we tell stories, and we have illustrations and art, and we get to work on it all at the same time, which is really nice.
So speaking of covers, which are, as I mentioned, really attractive, I took a look on the various past issues that are available, the cover photos of the issues on your webpage. Mm. And first of all, I noticed that the cover conveys already a message. You can Yes. clearly foresee what's inside. And I noticed that, correct me if I'm wrong, because it is just my impression, I want you to clarify what actually your intention was. You are a bimonthly magazine, so you have a time, relatively a small amount, but still some time to prepare the content in advance. Comparing, for instance, to daily
yeah, absolutely.
Daily journals and so on. So actually, I noticed that you prefer to rethink, to summarize some issues from the past. Like, for instance, you have the issue dedicated to Ukraine's unfinished story. You have Tales from the Baltics to commemorate 35th anniversary of decline of the Soviet Union. You also have the issue dedicated to the Belarusian protests year after they have emerged. So, it correct me if I'm wrong, but it seems like you prefer to not to write in a rush directly after some peculiar and important events take place, but to sit down, to rethink something and convey the message you would like to spread to the world only after the some thoughts can be collected. Is
I
it
think,
your strategy?
yeah, I think it's a good assessment, absolutely. And we try not to fall into this trap of chasing a story because we are bi-monthly, and if we're trying to cover it at that time where we're putting it together by, you know, by the time it gets out, and we have this international distribution, there's always delays actually of getting the issue on the shelves, especially in countries like Australia and the US or Canada. We cannot pretend that we are going to be like covering the breaking stories and like the current issue, which is a hot issue at the moment. Of course, with a topic like pandemic, it was much longer, so we could do it. But we didn't do it in March, you know, we did it
Yeah,
back, we did it in September.
six months later, right?
Exactly. And so what we really want to do is exactly digest these topics. And I like to say that we are our approach is a little bit like slow journalism. We are not breaking news. We are trying to rather digest it, try to understand it, look in between the lines, provide, and of course, all of that in the context of the region of Central and Eastern Europe, the voices from the region. So, for example, one of my favorite covers actually was our issue we did on migration back in 2015. So, here we had the migration crisis in Europe. The migrants were coming from the Middle East through the Balkans, through Hungary. And here we
When
have.
Poland couldn't even imagine such problem at that time.
Yes. Well, that's well, and what we actually decided to do was let's look at it from a different angle. And we looked at migrants coming to Poland from Ukraine, for example, which was starting at that time. We looked at migrants. Also, like migrants in Belarus, which nobody even was covering, and migration, how Russia deals with migrants, like not looking at the like in this crisis situation because we were in a crisis situation, but migration has always been around and it's always been happening in different ways and different forms. So that's how we tried to break it down a little bit in that way. Of course, we covered Hungary and we covered the Balkans, how they were, you know, a part of this migration crisis. But we also wanted to take a different angle and show that processes that are taking place in the world, there is always some part of it that can be related to our region in Central and Eastern Europe. And that's very natural for any region, of course. You know, we can probably look at any global region. The processes that are taking place in the world, all of the whole world is a part of in some way or some form. So our role is to put the Eastern European piece out there. That's basically how we approach it.
And come with the general conclusions that can be applicable for any country, for any problem elsewhere.
Yes, yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. And not always though you'll notice that we will sometimes we'll take some historical approach. We did an issue on 1918 back in 2018, so it was about the you know looking at the year of independence. So for Poland, of course, was very important, but for other countries in the region. And I think a lot of people forget about what was happening in the region, you know, with particularly in Ukraine and Belarus. Towards the end of the First World War, there was a lot of kind of forgotten stories. And so that we also took some historical perspectives. And we try to mix it up a little bit. So you mentioned that we'll sometimes have a focus on a country like Ukraine or Belarus. We'll have a focus on the region, like the Baltic states, the Balkans. We did a Central Asia issue. And then we tried to pick also just broader topics and then put our pieces in there. So we did an issue, for example, on values and how do we approach values considering the current situation in our region and in Europe. How do we, what was another one that I wanted to mention? The pandemic, of course, was an important one. And so in that way, and then this was also one of my favorite. This was 2017, when the rise of populism was really starting to grow in our region, but also in Europe. So again, we make these connections that it's not just an East-West thing. This is a global process. And we did an issue with our cover upside down, and this was called "The World Is Turning Upside Down." And that was one of my favorite covers. I will never. I think there's not much that can beat that cover, in my opinion. So we look at, you know, how we are changing our approach to, you know, to politics based on that. So yeah, we do a lot of different approaches in terms of topics, and we brainstorm. We have a team, kind of a wider team of, we have three full-time editors, but we have a lot of contributing editors who are part of our team in some way. So we will get together once a month or once every 2 months and brainstorm topics for future issues. And that's generally how we decide on what our approach is going to be for the coming issues.
Just another small footnote, because the another section of our conversation is incoming in 7 minutes. I would invite all our distinguished participants who listen to our conversation to type and ask potential questions for our guest, if there are any specific questions concerning New Eastern Europe and Eastern Europe.
This is one thing I wanted to mention too, about the reflecting on 10 years. And not everybody likes the title New Eastern Europe. We are stuck on it, of course, because the original publication, Polish Nowa Europa Wschodnia, was what set us up. Yes, exactly. The heritage of that. And as you can notice, we actually had a different logo in the beginning with this, what we call kapuka here, which was and still is in the Nowa Europa Wschodnia logo. But once we split the journals, the publishers asked us to kind of reformat everything.
Copyrights.
So we redesigned the logo, and I'm thinking about slight alterations in the future. I don't know if we will do it or not. But not everybody likes the title New Eastern Europe, because it does, Eastern Europe can be considered, you know, it's this, in, if we think about this discussion of orientalization of the region, that you know, we don't want to do. Our aim is really to break down stereotypes. The new is the most important word in our title, and to promote the fact that this region is not the way that we thought about it 15, 20, 30 years ago. It is new. It is dynamic. It is very diverse. It is very unique. And that's why we think it's very important that our audience pays attention to it, and that people learn about the region through our magazine. So I just want to also put out there, one little funny story was when we launched the journal, we decided to go we had some funding to do a small promotion in London. So we met with a lot of experts and think tanks. And one of the first people that we ever met outside of Poland promoting New Eastern Europe, until this day, is a very strong friend and supporter of the magazine, is Edward Lucas. He was at that time with The Economist. And he is, I think now he's with SIPA and he's, he does some other things. But he's, I'm sure many of you recognize who Edward Lucas is. And we sat down and he's like, we met him at a coffee shop. He had 15 minutes for us. He was very busy. And we gave him a copy of the magazine and he looked at it and he says, well, the first thing I have to tell you is I hate your title. And that was, we were just launching and we're like, well, oh boy, this is not going to go. This is not going to be a very good discussion. But then he explained why he didn't like it because he is very much a proponent of ending these types of regionalizations and orientalizations of the region through geographical type terms like Eastern Europe. He has a whole presentation about how we have to stop using Eastern Europe altogether. But since then, he's been very friendly. He's even written for us. And we had a moment in 2015 where we lost some funding. And thanks to him, we did a whole campaign, a letter writing campaign, and got some funding back. And he was one of the main supporters of that. So he was trying to be, I think, constructively critical.
Let me in that case ask you, unfortunately, a bit provocative question.
Please.
Concerning your previous answer to the title and the idea of the magazine. I looked upon the webpage and then general description of New Eastern Europe as the magazine, and I found the description as follows. The mission of New Eastern Europe is to shape the debate, enhance understanding, and further the dialogue surrounding issues facing the states that were once a part of the Soviet Union or under its influence. I clearly understand that you want to build the bridge between the West and East, and not to focus too much about Eastern direction as from the geographical point of view. But in that case, concerning this this description on the webpage, what role does the Soviet and post and Russian heritage play in your point of view, from your point of view, for the development of the region these days?
This is a very important question, and something that we debate in general about how to approach, you know, our region, because the countries today, which we call post-Soviet states, are very different from each other, and they are not as they were 30 years ago when we were watching the collapse of the Soviet Union about to happen. And one of the things that we even debate is whether we should be even using this expression post-Soviet, and we haven't come up with an answer yet, actually. Should we use it or should we not? We understand, I mean, traveling to the region and talking to all of our colleagues and friends from those countries, there is still something that uniquely connects these post-Soviet states, which we can call post-Soviet. But at the same time, like I said, there are so many changes taking place. So how to approach it is really challenging. I think there is still a legacy and heritage in those countries in particular. Homo Sovieticus or post-Soviet heritage or Soviet heritage, Russian influence in some way or form, all plays roles and factors in the region, and sometimes not a positive factor or a positive role. And we can see in the last several years in particular, the role that that Russia plays, particularly we can say Kremlin policy in the region and its approach to its wanting to have a sphere of influence in the region, have the region as its sphere of influence, let's say, really does cause a lot of problems for the region's development. And, you know, I think I don't ever want to see that these countries become, or, you know, referred to as a buffer zone. This is definitely, you know, there are some thinking that, you know, we have to just consider those countries like Ukraine, Moldova, Georgia as like an in-between Europe and Russia. because, you know, when you meet with people and when you talk to people from those countries, or you go to those countries, you might see the post-Soviet heritage, but at the same time, you see the European heritage, and you see the desire to be a part of Europe, and you see the interest and the need to be considered, you know, European, and the heart of Europe, you know, doesn't have to be in the European Union. We can find many hearts of Europe throughout, and including in the countries of Eastern Europe. So it's a really big challenge. I think, you know, that we have hit, you know, some really important crossroads over the last 10 years. We've made some important progress, but there's also been a lot of regress, a lot of step backwards, or just impasses where there has been no progress or no regress at all, if we look at some of the frozen conflicts as well. So it's a really challenging approach to the region. I think, you know, at New Eastern Europe, we will definitely and always have the approach that it's better to include these societies as part of the broader Europe, even if they're not officially members of the European Union. We don't see them any different. And in fact, we see that their voices are needed now more than ever.
You speak of Kremlin's activity as a very important factor. Actually, throughout the last decade, since 2013, since Putin was elected again as the president in 2012, Russia has come back to its imperialistic policy. And I think it really affected everything that happened, that has happened in the Eastern Europe so far. And provided you somehow, I really didn't know how to formulate this question to at least to sound diplomatic. Mm-hmm. Would you agree that Russia is and remains some sort of very infamous source of inspiration for the content?
For the content of the journal?
Yes. Could you imagine the content of New Eastern Europe without Russia?
Russia is always in the background. There's the, you know, the shadow of the bear. It will always be there. And maybe once that is gone, then there will be no need for New Eastern Europe anymore. Or New Eastern Europe would become just a more nice magazine where we don't talk about, you know, anything that's dark or, you know, any problems that are taking place in the region. I don't know. It's a very difficult question to answer. On the one hand, I mean, we can even go back. I'll phrase my answer this way, because I'm thinking about our new issue is about to come out. We've had a huge delay probably the biggest delay we've ever had in the last 10 years. But our new issue is about to come out. And we have one section which is looking at the legacy of the 30 years of the fall of the Soviet Union. And I did an interview with Serhii Plokhy from Harvard about the fall of the Soviet Union and his, you know, his reaction when I ask him about what's happening today, how do we understand it, you know, the Russian legacy in the region, is that, you know, the fall of the Soviet Union is still taking place. So in his opinion, and I probably agree with it as well, that you know, major events that are taking place in the region that go beyond, let's say, kind of small internal issues, affairs, are still really a part of this process. And this process will continue to take place as long as the Kremlin or those in charge of Russia see that they can try to hold on to this imperial legacy and try to keep some sort of imperial legacy. What it really requires is that some recognition inside Russia by the authorities that that the empire is over, that, you know, that period has ended, and it's time to just, you know, develop our own country, you know, if we're Russians, to develop Russia as its own country and give up on these imperialistic ambitions. And until we hit that moment, Russian influence or Russian, I don't know, maybe not influence, the impact, let's say, of even Russia's like policies in the region will always play some sort of role in the region. So I think for the moment, we can say yes is the short answer to your question. Is that there will always be at some level or some form some sort of Russian part, even if it's not direct. When we're looking at the big issues of the region, particularly when we're looking at how to end or bridge this divide between East and West.
Are there many Russian contributors for your magazine? Do they, are they eager to cooperate with you?
It's been a lot harder these days to find Russian contributors, but we have a few, and we actually, but it's not easy. And I have to say that in the beginning, it was much easier. But, you know, things weren't controversial back then. We could approach, you know, people who were considered respected analysts or journalists or writers, and it wouldn't be an issue to publish them before 2013. But now there's the lens of who says what. Can we, you know, is it controversial to put this person in the magazine? Would they even agree to it? So for the moment, I think we are close to some academics who are brave. Some Russian, of course, Russian contributors who aren't in Russia. That's the easiest, you know, they're willing to work with us. We have plenty of contributors who are Russian, but not inside Russia. And we have a few journalists from like, who contribute, for example, to Novaya Gazeta, these kind of circles. But it's not easy. And, you know, I think really to understand what's happening in the region, we do also need to understand what's happening in Russia. But the sphere, you know, information sphere and the public sphere and the discussion and debate sphere inside Russia is so closed and controlled and in some ways orchestrated that it's really hard to get someone who's really good who could you know contribute without any sort of either, you know, pro-Kremlin bias or even anti-Kremlin bias. Is to be objective, I found that in many, you know, in our region, to find someone who is objective is nearly impossible, which is fine because we do have a lot of opinion pieces, but to be able to be subjective, but at the same time, open to other sides of the story is also challenging.
But have you ever encountered any official feedback from the side of the Russian authorities on your journal?
Russia, no. I don't think so. I don't even know if we're on their radar so much. Maybe slightly. There are some stories of, you know, where we show up in press and somebody says, oh, it's just a CIA-funded project, you know, which we, I know our budget and we are nowhere near CIA-funded. But in terms of, we've never received any official feedback from Russia. I can say we've received official feedback from other countries such as Azerbaijan or Belarus. These things every now and then come our way, but Russian authorities, no, I think we're too small of a fish for them to worry about.
No, for sure, you are already interested in Russia, so Russia doesn't have to be interested in you.
True, that is true.
But speaking again of the scope of your potential authors and contributors. You invite numerous experts who share their knowledge, their opinions about the region. They are both people from the respective countries of the Central and Eastern Europe, and also, as you mentioned, for instance, professor from Harvard, right? So from the, let's say, Western, from the Western part. Is the region, I mean, The region itself is full of contradicting conflicts, rights and expectations. There are both historical, frozen and recent political conflicts, and you have somehow to approach them if they appear. Is it difficult for you as the editorial board, as the magazine composed of multinational crew, to share your objective opinion on particular issue, to make sure that you won't be considered disregarding some other party to the conflict? For instance, what comes into my mind in first place is the conflict concerning Nagorno-Karabakh. I'm sure that whenever some conflict occurs, people from these countries try to offer to you their insights. They want them to be published. How do you deal with such problems?
I think from our actually personal experience, from my personal experience, the Nagorno-Karabakh in particular is the most difficult one to find, because it's such a polarizing topic, and to find, you know, every, and we have some contributors from Armenia, we have some contributors from Azerbaijan, and I like all of them. I think they're very, you know, good people, and they want the best for their countries. But when it comes to the conflict itself, you can, it's really, really hard to find an objective opinion. And we have, I think, for the most part, decided on that conflict, especially, is to find analysts outside the region to write about it from an objective point of view. We can, you know, if we do cover something that is a very polarizing topic, we try our best to get two voices, so both sides, and allow the readers to decide what's the opinion they agree the most on. But that being said, we do not, you know, we do not want to publish propaganda or disinformation or anything that's completely false or would even make, you know, the conflict worse. So even if there are analysts out there, we have to make sure that they can do their best to be objective in some form. It doesn't happen a lot because we've become sensitized to it. So maybe in the beginning we had a few times where we would publish a piece and then realize that it was so sided towards one side, we would get attacked by the other side, you know, on social media or by emails, or you know, or the authorities would send us some message or email. But I think that we've become more sensitive to it. So we really know how to navigate these really sensitive topics, find good experts who can be objective if possible, or present two voices, as I said. So, I mean, but it doesn't mean it doesn't happen. It still happens. And we just have to, we really try our best to be sensitive to it.
And I'm pretty sure you can very easily find what propaganda is and what is not, taking into account that, if I'm not mistaken, your field of expertise is inter alia fake news, right? So you must be experienced when approaching such attempts to deliver you the content that.
But at the same time, our mission, you know, absolutely. I think we do a pretty good job at avoiding any sort of propaganda. But at the same time, we do fall into the trap once in a while, you know, because our mission is to be a voice of the region. And so there's this really thin line of like, okay, I can give you a story. This is a story that happened to us. We had an author write a piece for a website. So, We publish, you know, the journal, but on our website we also have additional texts which are a little bit more, you know, the same aim, but they are more relevant to kind of current events. And we had one article which was written by an expert at a think tank based in Azerbaijan, think tank which is of course close to the government. About the elections, parliamentary elections, the last round that they had a few years ago, maybe a year or two years ago, maybe, and how this was, you know, in her, it was her personal opinion, written in a way that, you know, she feels that this is a new generation coming to age in Azerbaijan. They're able, there are a lot of younger people who were entering into politics, if they can define the future of it. And I read the article and I thought it was okay. It was, you know, a little promoting a state narrative, perhaps promoting, you know, a national feeling. And, but it, at the same time, it was clear it was her opinion. And it was clear that that she was writing from her point of view. And I didn't think it was controversial. And we read it together with my other editor and we said, okay, we can publish it. And the moment that we published it, we were immediately attacked on social media by experts in disinformation, among others. And they saw us as just a channel promoting Azerbaijani propaganda in the West. And even to the point, I was attacked by people who I personally know, who I've been in conferences with, who I, you know, have sat down and had discussions over beers with. And I get one message, or there's one message that comes on social media, says, oh, Eastern Europe was probably just bought out by Azerbaijani oil. And I know the guy who said it, and I wrote him a message. I said, what are you talking about? And he said, well, you're publishing propaganda now. And we had an emergency meeting with our web editor and our team. And I made the most difficult decision I ever made in my entire life. It was the only time it ever happened, over 10 years. And so I think it's okay. But I said to Daniel, my web editor, I said, Daniel, remove the article and I will write a personal email to the author apologizing why we had to take it down. This was really probably one of the most difficult things that we've ever had to do. But the moment that we removed it, all of those social media posts, like I messaged the guys and I said, hey, you know, sorry for confusion, we took it down. And they're like, okay, we'll delete all our Facebook posts and tweets. And so they deleted all that. And, you know, that was like putting out the fire immediately like this. So it must have been too sensitive for these people. But it was actually at the height, you know, like 2 years ago when cancel culture was maybe even more of a thing than it is now. I don't know, maybe it still is a thing. But I really like feared that this was the moment that Eastern Europe was going to get canceled because we published a pro Azerbaijani state type of text. And from that point on, we said, okay, we have to add extra filters in our own when we're reading these articles. So it was a learning experience, but I really felt terrible. I mean, really terrible that I had to take the article down.
Well, it appears that the negative outcome is still always an outcome. So you learned something very important from that story, even though you unfortunately suffered a bit. And while you described this process, it really reminded me of some sort of hate speech, really, but on the very, nonetheless, professional level. It's not even the political one, right? It's not about the politicians who don't like their own opinions, comments, but it was among experts.
Yes, exactly.
Experts in some field, and we require even more from the academics, from the professionals to behave.
And so I'm not going to name any names, but if I did, you would recognize them all. So these are, you know, high level experts in the field and people, like I said, people who I personally know and have interacted with and who have written for us. And to see this, like how easy it is for kind of this fire of just attack. And that's how I felt. Yeah, it is quite scary. And you know, I could have gotten a private message first because I know these people personally. They could have sent me a private message, say, hey, what's the deal? And then, you know, we could discuss it and say, it looks really bad. Maybe you should consider, you know, another voice or something like this. But instead, it was a public, you know, a public beating of our brand, and I had to make the difficult decision to save the brand at the cost of you know, publishing someone's opinion.
Let me go to the first and so far the last question from the audience. Agnieszka Witłaszewska asks, a quick question about the future. Any special plans for the coming years? New ideas for new Eastern Europe?
Hi, Agnieszka. Thanks for joining us.
Hi.
Great to see you. And you're asking about future issues, I guess, maybe?
Just in general, if you have any ideas, because of course the New Eastern Europe is not just the journal itself. You have a lot of other projects going on, a lot of elements to it. So just a question, if you have any special ideas, any reflections after these 10 years, what you would like to do more or differently or anything like that? Thanks.
Thanks. Yeah, I think, in general, the beginning of the year is always a difficult time for us because we start the year with a big question mark of how much funding we're going to have for the year. But that doesn't stop us from making plans. And so I can first maybe share a little bit about the next coming up issues. This issue, which is coming out, will be available online, I think even tomorrow. But the first issue of next year is looking really at kind of we're revisiting overall strategy of Europe in the region and whether it's really working or not. And we are asking these questions among people from the West, but also from the East, because we've, like we said, 2009 was the launch of the Eastern Partnership and there's baby steps towards Europe. What can we be doing differently? So that's going to be our first issue, which is kind of a standard for New Eastern Europe. But the second issue is what I'm really excited about, is we're actually going to take a look at the role that trauma plays in the region. We have a lot of societies which are traumatized or do not have closure on conflict issues. And this is in almost every country in our region. So we are going to have kind of a broad discussion of trauma and how it really affects societies. And I think this will be quite deep, I hope. This is our plan for the second issue of the year. In terms of, for example, we have the podcast, Talk Eastern Europe, which thank you, Agnieszka, you are one of our supporters. We are very happy for that, so thank you. We are looking at, actually, Maciek is my co-host. We are going to have a brainstorm session at the end of the year, and hopefully we will also involve our patrons who are supporting the podcast, but looking at, we had just talked about, we're going to come up with ideas on how to take the podcast to the next level, which means, which could mean some change of format, maybe some additional contributors or co-hosts. We haven't made any decisions yet, but we do think that the podcast has a really expanded audience. We launched the podcast in 2018, and now I think, you know, each episode after, you know, two or three weeks of publishing it has over 1,000 listens per episode, which is pretty good. So we really want to focus a bit more and try to also find additional funding for the podcast activities as well. So developing a podcast, and the issues as well. We had talked about, I don't know if we are going to do this or not. The end of the year is always a really difficult time, so maybe it'll be throughout next year. But because we now hit 10 years of New Eastern Europe, how we can also maybe upgrade a little bit of our layout. We don't want to touch too much of it because our readers' feedback is that they really like our layout, but I would like to maybe kind of give it a little bit of a facelift, including perhaps, but maybe not, our logo as well. So, I mean, we have a lot of things that are kind of in the air for the moment, but we haven't had the time to sit down and really focus on plans for more than the next 4 or 5 months.
Great, thanks a lot.
Adam, we are slowly approaching the end of our very interesting meeting. I would like to ask you the last question, not necessarily related to the New Eastern Europe itself, but I believe it will become relevant in the future. I would like to ask you, as American and as a person whose field of expertise and interest is also the security. 10 days ago, the director of the National Intelligence, Avril Haines, appeared in Warsaw. There was a series of meetings with Polish authorities, including Minister of Interior, Prime Minister of Poland, Mateusz Morawiecki. People connect these meetings with the Russian threat at the Ukrainian borders. Right now, the meeting of the ministers of foreign affairs from the NATO member states was concluded in Riga. The main topic was also the potential threat and escalation and Russian escalation on the Ukrainian border. Is this threat something that we should be worried even more than in the past? Is it the threat that we should take much more seriously than in 2014, in the first in the beginning of 2021? What would be your take on the current status of the conflict?
Yeah, I think, well, it's a very dangerous situation, no matter what. I mean, the fact that there are, you know, troops and military hardware being massed on the border with Ukraine, and the entire situation that we have across the border with Belarus is really, I mean, we have not seen this type of situation, particularly, I mean, the situation in Belarus, Poland, since, you know, since the end of the Cold War, has not had this type of situation where its borders are threatened, you know, in this type of manner, in any manner, to say, is this is unprecedented. So I think definitely we have to be worried a little bit about what is happening. I think in the end, I mean, I do not expect, of course, anything can happen, but my gut tells me that it probably will not be, you know, we should not expect any sort of war, or, you know, there might be a few days of conflict, because that's more, if we look at the history of how the Kremlin's strategy is in the region, it's more about using the threat of force to its political advantage to destabilize the region, or to destabilize countries, to destabilize political situations, if it's, I don't know, in either in Georgia or in Ukraine or in any other countries that it can, it would like to. So I think rather what Russia's strategy here is to really put pressure on Ukraine. But what is different now, and what has not, which I think maybe we're not talking about enough of, is the fact that Ukraine has developed its defense capabilities over these last, you know, 7 years in ways that it has never had before. So I think even if there is going to be some sort of conflict that might start, you know, Ukraine might show that it's willing to stand up for its own defense, and that the question is, in which way will it escalate? Will Russia back down? That would be seen as a loss for Putin, and I think unacceptable. Or would it escalate to a point where we will have, you know, a stronger or greater conflict right across the borders from NATO and the European Union? And just hearing what Lukashenko said yesterday, or the day, I think it was yesterday, in terms of Belarus will, you know, stand by and defend Russia, and, or, you know, or even attack Ukraine if it's required, I think is very concerning, because we know that Putin is much more calculative, and there is, you know, some sort of method to the madness, but Lukashenko this past year or two is really just mad, and I'm worried that that is where the kind of unintended, let's say, consequences of this, of military buildup, of tensions, could turn into something greater. So I mean, I'm not going to predict war. Like I said, my gut is that this is going to be, this is more of, these are just kind of, you know, tools to try to put pressure in the region and to kind of show that that they have control of the situation, which is probably not fully the case. But at the same time, there's always, when this happens, there's always a risk that something might, something unintended might happen. And how will NATO respond? How will individual countries in the region respond? We are not sure yet. And this is what we need to worry about a little bit.
So this is where we can finish with this sort of suspense to be continued in 2022.
And let's try to be optimistic. This has been, especially these last 2 years, I think for everybody, these in particular, but because of the pandemic and all the the unknowns regarding that, has really been difficult years for everybody, I think, and for us as a print publication, when there was lockdowns and distribution of publications completely stopped for 5 or 6 months, that was really hardest, probably the hardest period that I can think of over the last 10 years of doing New Eastern Europe. So I am going to try to remain hopeful that 2022 is going to bring positive results, that perhaps maybe everyone will start coming to their senses, and that we will find new ways to be optimistic about the future.
This is for sure this piece of legacy of New Eastern Europe that should be remembered and reminded. As you mentioned, in 2011, you were very optimistic about what the future can offer. So I hope the next year and the next decade will be the same. They will be promising, full of new opportunities, and with Russia or without Russia, full of very intriguing content. Thank you, Adam, for you coming here today. I wish you successful development of the magazine. It's already December, so also Merry Christmas and a Happy New Year. And thank you all our participants for listening to this interview. Follow both Forum of Young Diplomats and New Eastern Europe in the social media. Thank you for the conversation. Have a nice evening.
Thank you so much, Grzegorz. It was my pleasure. This was really a great conversation.
Thank you. See you soon.